Next day with us, so COVID. Sounds like a brother, COVID. Hi, COVID.
Oh my God,
COVID-19 is still long enough to be
COVID-19. I mean, it just sounds like just hey, COVID. COVID is still here. So figures are beginning to climb in the past 2 weeks. In fact, last Friday, the country recorded its highest daily tally of 796 since the outbreak in Nigeria. So the question is, how prepared are we? Joining us on the show is the National Coordinator for the Presidential Task Force on COVID-19, Dr. Sani Aliu. So good to have you, Dr. Aliu. Are you still there? Are you there?
Yes, I'm still there. Good morning.
Yes,
good
morning, good to have you on the show. We're a bit frightened by the new numbers of COVID in Nigeria and the fact that there's a possibility that you might be making us go into another lockdown. I mean, if the numbers continue to grow. Could you give us an update exactly? What data do you have for us? And what plans are you putting in place to not get us to a lockdown?
So I'm afraid it's not looking good at the moment. The numbers are clearly going up. There's no doubt we're having an upward trend, a second surge of the epidemic. And we strongly believe that this is driven by community transmission. Over the last few weeks, what has changed compared to late October and early November is the frequency of parties and weddings and mass gatherings where people have completely thrown caution to the wind. No face masks, no physical distancing. It's almost like people are asking COVID and daring COVID to come and get them. And we know what we're seeing in both Lagos and Abuja. Our treatment centers are fast filling up. People need to realize that they are playing a Russian roulette with their lives. And this has got to stop. So when you ask me, how can we avoid lockdown? Well, it's in the hands of the communities and the people. If we continue with this sort of behavior, no responsible government will sit down and allow a pandemic to take hold in the country. And people die. And we know what we're seeing in our treatment centers. And when we run out of ICU beds, no matter who you are, if you require ICU and ventilation, and there are people on ventilation, we're not going to switch off anybody's ventilator in order to get you off. So we've really got to be responsible. Those key non-pharmaceutical interventions, wearing face masks all the time, especially in public, ensuring that you avoid crowds, ensuring that you avoid contamination of your hands, washing your hands frequently. And more importantly, if you have symptoms of a cold, don't go into the public. These are simple measures that will stop this from progressing. But unless we do that, and government is, we have been meeting, we've met with the FCT, and we're going to have another Zoom call later on this evening with Lagos State. And tomorrow we'll have a PTS meeting.
Right.
But definitely, if people want us to go back to where we were in March, April, then the current behavior is really pushing towards that.
Okay, all right.
Okay, Dr. Ali.
It's most unfortunate.
Yeah, Dr. Ali, you're right. It is really, it's quite unfortunate. But I would just like to find out what the plans are. I mean, given human behavior where we don't listen, we don't follow the guidelines. So we're hoping that government is better prepared this time. The centers going back up, those who will be involved, the doctors and nurses, do they have PPEs now? You know, are they better equipped to handle a second surge?
So we're doing all that we can to prevent a second surge. The way public health works, you try not to overwhelm your health system. So no matter how prepared you are, if you allow things to progress, and you have too many people getting sick all at once, it will overwhelm the system. In terms of preparation, to be honest, we are actually better off now than we were in March, April. We have a lot more diagnostic capacity in terms of the molecular labs. Virtually every state government has a molecular lab now. Virtually every state has some form of a treatment center. We've trained more than 45,000 healthcare workers on infection prevention and control. We also continue to distribute personal protective equipment across the state. We've also given each state a minimum of 1 billion naira to deal with the COVID pandemic, which includes risk communication, so radio jingles, TV adverts, engagement with the community leaders. And we've met with the community leaders and our traditional rulers and religious leaders. But what's happening is that people are getting fatigued with COVID. We're all very tired. We've been doing this for the last 9 months. Some of us have not even seen our families for almost a year. So it's difficult, but what we need to understand is COVID is not tired. We might be getting fatigued and tired, but as far as COVID is concerned, it's great. COVID could have a really great Christmas if we continue to behave in this way.
Right.
And we cannot allow COVID to celebrate Christmas with us. It's all about changing human behavior and realizing our risk. Those of us that are 50, between 50 to 60, if we catch COVID based on our data, almost one in four persons between the ages of 50 to 60 died. So, and I, for instance, have a 1 in 4 chance of dying if I catch COVID in Nigeria, based on our Nigeria data.
Right.
And that's not something you want. It's the equivalent of playing Russian roulette. We've got to protect ourselves. So if you are elderly, if you have diabetes, if you have cardiovascular disease, keep away from the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever your age, even if you are young, do not follow the crowd because you could infect yourself and carry this to your loved ones and decimate them in the process.
All right.
Great.
Two questions quickly, Dr. Aliyu.
I hear that some countries, they've announced that they are ready with the vaccines. How are we positioned as a country to get the vaccines when they start distributing to other countries? That's one. Secondly, what is our testing capacity at the moment? Can you give us an update on that?
So I'll start with the second one. So our testing capacity, at the moment, we're testing about 4,000 samples a day. The key issue we are now having, as I said, laboratories are now available across the country. The key issue is really getting the support of people to come out and actually test. We know that a lot of people are not coming forward, even when they have symptoms. Mm-hmm. One of the common symptoms that we've observed, especially in young people, is the loss of smell. So if you've just had a cold or you have a mild cold and suddenly you lose your sense of smell, it's most likely COVID. Certainly the ones I've come across, they've all turned out to be positive, especially if you're a relatively young person. And then other symptoms, fever is particularly common, cough, shortness of breath, et cetera. So when it comes to diagnostic capacity, what we know from our data is that for every positive we have, it's very likely we're missing up to 10 cases because people are failing to come forward to test. We have, in Abuja, for instance, access to testing is very easy. If you go to the National Reference Lab in Kaduna, you just drive in. You don't need to call anybody. You just drive in. You will not even come out of your car. They will take your details. They will swab you, and off you go. And they will call you or send you a text message if you're negative or call you if you're positive 24, 48 hours later. So diagnostic capacity has improved, but that demand hasn't been commensurate with the expansion of diagnostic laboratories across the country.
The
another thing that I would say about vaccine is even if today we start a vaccine program, the rate of rise of COVID-19 will not change over the following 1, 2, 3 months unless we change our behavior.
Right.
Vaccine alone is not enough to interrupt transmission at the population level rapidly, because you need to build your immunity. Most of the vaccines have to be given as 2 courses, 3 to 4 weeks apart. So, and we require that in order to have a decent antibody response. And then, well, they are 95% effective, which is pretty good. But there are other challenges, such as the need to maintain an ultra cold chain, and also the competition, because a lot of the developed countries are busy buying off the vaccine. But government is doing a lot of work through Primary Healthcare Development Agency. They are the key lead with the Federal Ministry of Health. Funds are being identified for the purpose of procuring the vaccine through the Gavi Initiative, where we'll have 20%, about 20% of the population will be catered for. But even then, we will only give the vaccine to 3 groups, certainly in phase one.
Right.
Healthcare workers,
Dr. Liu,
the elderly, and those with comorbidities. So not everybody will get the vaccine, I'm afraid.
Right.
That's
right. Dr. Liu, I have to ask you this question. I know you might not like it, but we can't shy away from the reality that Africa was what we could say is the least affected continent across the world with COVID. I mean, people have been amazed at the results from, especially Nigeria, the numbers compared to other countries. So Remember in the early days, we were talking about maybe there's something in Africa, there's something in our air, in our weather, or something that that just did not allow COVID to get to the height it did across the world. Now, it's 9 months past. Do you think, has there been any research done to give us some, to validate these assumptions, or is it still just a speculation, or because people don't see people dying like they do abroad. Maybe that's why they're just going around their normal lives.
You're quite right. People don't, COVID doesn't have that shock factor of people bleeding to death, like with Ebola or Lassa, for instance, or people dropping dead or with flu and effects across the population. But one of the main reasons why is because we have a relatively young population. The median age in Nigeria is 18 years. In Nigeria, if you're above the age of 65, you're only about 3% of the population, compared to 18% for the UK and 21% of the Italian population being above the age of 65. So the most likely reason why we are not seeing the impact of COVID is because it's primarily affecting people in their 30s in Nigeria. And these are young people that may not even exhibit any symptoms at all. But if it catches an elderly person, as I said earlier on, if it catches you and you're between 50 to 60, almost one in four, 23% mortality. If you're above 60, 27-28% mortality based on our data. And I remember very clearly around April, some of us were commenting on how mild the infection was for India. And look at where India is at the moment. It has the second or third highest mortality rate in the world. If you talk about weather, our weather is very similar to that of Brazil. We're practically on the same latitude. Yeah. And look at what's happening in Brazil. One of the reasons why I strongly feel that Africa was saved the brunt of the COVID pandemic was partly because of the nature of our democracy, relatively young population, but also the fact that African countries went in very quickly. Remember, March, April, when we locked down, we had only a handful of 100 cases of COVID. We locked down very early on and stopped the transmission. And then secondly, people are more likely to be outdoors in Africa than indoors. And we know transmission is not very efficient if you are outdoors, not because of the weather, but because of the wind, etc. And thirdly, our leaders, our political leaders, have shown true leadership in that there are no mixed messages coming from our leaders. If you look at countries where the leaders have shown mixed messages, like the United States, like Brazil, for instance, like a few other countries in Southeast Asia, they've had awful epidemics. But what I'm trying to say is this virus is no different to the virus in Europe. It's no different to the virus in North America when it comes to its pathogenicity, i.e. its likelihood of causing disease and its likelihood of killing people. It's just that it prefers older people or those with other comorbidities. And if you have that and it catches you, it doesn't matter whether you are black or you are white or you are pink. It can still cause severe illness in you and death. And secondly, we need to be aware that our health system is weak compared to the health system of other countries.
Yeah.
If I catch COVID and I'm in the UK, for instance, if I need intensive care, straight away, I'm very likely to access intensive care. If I need oxygen, within minutes of arriving hospital, I'll have oxygen. But that isn't the case for a lot of our hospitals in Nigeria, particularly those in the rural areas. We could suffocate to death because all we need is oxygen.
Let me get a few more questions.
With our lives in the first instance? Why? I really can't understand this attitude. We really got to change our behavior and realize that this is for real. Let's try and survive this Christmas period. Let's try and survive the early part of 2021.
Right. Let me get a few more questions in for you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Aliyu. I agree with everything you have said to why we do not have the numbers we have here, except, of course, the mixed messages from our leaders. I do agree with you on that. But I just want to find this conversation about the vaccine, which seems to be, a lot of people think it's almost like a cure. And I don't think we're talking enough about vaccine being more preventive than being, you know, a cure. Could you just educate us better on what the vaccine would do?
So what the vaccine does is it's just like what other vaccines that we have for measles, mumps, and the childhood vaccines do. Essentially, they trick the body. They pretend to be the true organism, and the body produces antibodies as a result. And at the same time, the body also produces a number of immune cells called memory cells that then go back and wait for the infection to come in. And the moment the infection comes in, because the body has already been trained, the body has been shown, okay, here we are. This is what looks like a coronavirus. It has a spike protein on its surface. So if you see this spike protein, this is what you produce. You produce soldiers that will fight it. And these soldiers are so well trained that they know the weakness of the organism. So it's almost like you mobilize troops. Essentially, what a vaccine does is you catch an amoeba and you show the amoeba or you show an enemy to a troop of soldiers. And you ask the soldiers, do you recognize this person? Yes. Do you recognize them? Yes. Okay, go back and rest. Next time, if the same person comes around, they will immediately recognize that this is an enemy and they will mobilize. And that's how a vaccine works.
Right.
However, different people have different levels of antibody response. If you look at the antibodies as the soldiers, some may produce a large number of soldiers. Some may only be able to produce 5 or 10 soldiers. So you could easily be overwhelmed. And that's why when it comes to vaccination, you cannot have 100% efficacy. So the two vaccines that are currently most likely to come in very soon and are being used have about 95% efficacy. And the vaccine that's being produced by the Oxford vaccine has about 70-something percent efficacy.
Right. Unfortunately, we have to...
The vaccines that are currently being used require a lot of very cold environment in order to remain stable. And that's one of the challenges we have when it comes to logistics.
We have to wrap up on this. Unfortunately, we run out of time. But thank you very much, Dr. Aliyu. I think if there's anything we've gotten from you today, don't play Russian roulette with our lives. And don't let COVID spend Christmas with us this year.
Never.
I think that's two messages resound in Nigerians' minds today. Thank you very much for joining us. Have a fabulous day. We'll see you all tomorrow. Bye for now.